In this segment of Physics in Motion, we'll explain the science behind the wonder of electricity. Current electricity. This is a Tesla coil, named after a scientist who was sometimes called a mad inventor, but was definitely a genius, Nikola Tesla. He searched for a way to harness electricity without wires, but was outgunned by a competing method from a guy named Thomas Edison. But Tesla's work with antennas led to technology that is still used in TVs and radios today. And yes, he's the guy the cars were named after. We'll see more about how the Tesla coil works and what we can learn about electricity from it. But let's take a step back first. You might remember that there are two forms of electricity. First, there's static electricity, which is the accumulation of electric charge on a surface or within a material. Static electricity is associated with potential energy, which means it possesses the ability to do work. But it's the other form of electricity that defines so much of the way we live, and that's current electricity. Current electricity is the flow of electric charge. It's dynamic, so the charges are always on the move. It's what turns on our lights, runs our computers, and powers the modern world. It rarely exists in nature, but we do see it in lightning strikes. About 125 years ago, we started using electricity to power lights and motors and all the rest. Current electricity is a good name because it moves like currents of water flowing through a channel. To break that down, let's go back to basics. Atoms, we know, make up elements that make up all matter. And atoms are made up of protons, which have a positive charge, neutrons, which have no charge, and electrons, which whiz around the atom in an electron cloud, and of course has a negative charge. The charges create electric fields around them, and as we know, those fields exert force on whatever charges are in the vicinity. That force impels the other charges to move, but because the protons are bound within the nucleus of the atom, they can't really go anywhere. But the electrons, they're a different story. If electrons are part of a material that is a good conductor, like metal, they will move easily. That's why we make electric wires out of metal. Now remember electric potential? That's the energy capacity of the unit of charge. When there's a point of higher potential and one of lower potential, the electrons will want to move to that point of lower potential, like water will fall down a waterfall. Electric potential is the same as voltage, which is the energy capacity of a unit of charge. We can think of it as electric pressure, which is what pushes the charge down the wire. We measure it in units called volts. That's how a battery works. One terminal has high potential, the positive, and one has lower potential, the negative. So when we connect them by way of a wire, voila, the charges start to flow, making a current, current electricity. But here's something that might come as a surprise. The charge moves down the wire very slowly. It takes a few hours to move a meter. The electrons, though they move at almost the speed of light, are not moving in a constant direction. They move almost randomly, colliding with atoms and generally behaving like bumper cars. So why does this light bulb come on as soon as I hook up the battery? Though the current flows slowly, the electric field that drives it does not. It goes into effect throughout the whole length of the wire at almost the speed of light. So electrons begin moving through the entire wire almost as soon as the current begins. The electrons that are closest to the bulb light it up, while the charges that are further behind slowly make their way. As long as the parade of electrons continues past the charge point and the electric field is unbroken, the light stays lit. Let's look at the formula for the relationship between the electric force and electric field. F sub E, electric force, is equal to charge times electric field. This force is what pushes or pulls charge, making it flow. In a constant electric field, electrons will tend to flow in the same net direction, despite the pinballing around. The overall motion is in the direction of the electric force. And here's a weird thing to remember when we talk about electricity. We describe the flow in the reverse of the direction it actually goes. When Benjamin Franklin was investigating electricity more than 200 years ago, he thought a positive charge flowed through the wire toward a negative charge. The terminology just stuck, and we still talk about it that way today. But we now know that it's in reverse. The electrons, the negative charges, are what move, and the positive charges are bound in place. Now, even though electrons are flowing in the same basic direction, it doesn't mean that they aren't still hitting atoms along the way and creating friction as they do so. That is called resistance. Resistance is the opposition of a material to the flow of electric current. And what does friction cause? Heat, right? So when you feel the warmth of a wire or bulb or heating element in your hairdryer, you have the bumper car effect of electrons and atoms to thank for that. Or to blame if you get too close. Resistance, current, and voltage are interdependent. When one changes, at least one of the others do too. Let's look at how that works. I have two buckets. We've put holes in the bottom of these buckets, but this one has a larger hole. Both buckets have the same amount of water in them, creating the same amount of pressure on the hole in the bottom. Let's imagine these buckets are carrying charges instead of water. The level of water represents the voltage, the pressure created by the charge in the system, represented by V. The higher the level of water, the greater the voltage. The diameter of the hole in the bottom of the bucket represents electrical resistance, represented by R. Now, when I release the water from the buckets, let's see what happens. The water in the bucket with the smaller hole drains more slowly. It has the higher resistance. The other bucket has a larger hole, so the water flows more easily. The resistance is what? Right, lower. And the flow of water represents current, which we show as I. It's a measure of the flow rate of electric charge. The higher the resistance or smaller the hole, the lower the current flow, or water flowing out. So let's recap. Voltage is the push or pressure, and resistance is the resistance to flow. And current is the rate at which charges flow. Current is what results from voltage and resistance. There's a formula showing that resistance is inversely proportional to current when voltage is kept constant. Resistance equals voltage divided by current. You might also have seen the same equation arranged like this. V equals IR, or voltage equals current times resistance. This relationship is known as Ohm's Law, after the German physicist George Ohm, who figured out that in certain materials, voltage is directly proportional to current. Current, voltage, and resistance are interconnected, so when one changes, at least one of the others change too. Understanding that relationship led to our being able to harness electricity, but it didn't happen overnight. Remember this? In Tesla's coil, which Tesla invented in 1891, he used very high voltage so that a spark flies between the gap in the two coils. Tesla hoped to be able to transmit electricity directly through the air over very long distances, but you can see it was a little out there. Tesla made a lot of huge advances in our understanding of how electricity works, inventing alternating current, allowing us to transmit electricity long distances, and pioneering research with wireless electricity. We still use Tesla's technology today. For instance, when we charge our cell phones wirelessly. That's it for this segment of Physics in Motion. We'll see you next time.
For more practice problems, lab activities, and note-taking guides, check out the Physics in Motion Toolkit.